And check, 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 check. Listen, today's show, Elon Musk is coming to put a chip in your brain. We're talking about the Roots Picnic, and they're making another color purple. Creative entrepreneurs, it's time to tap in. This is Morning Coffee. Let's run the show. Wake it up, wake it up. Y'all know what day it is and what time it is. It's Friday, so that means it's time for another episode of what we call this here Morning Coffee. Y'all know what we do here. We talk about all the things that we need to be talking about as creative entrepreneurs so we can level up our journey. And let's get to this shmoney, y'all. You know what I'm saying? Getting paid to be ourselves and all that. And I can't front. I'm excited to be back. I feel like it's been a while. It's been a whole 2 weeks since I've been back in the studio with my folks. I think I missed y'all. You know what I'm saying?
Missed you too.
Man, I'm glad to be back. But listen, I can't front though. Scarlett held it all the way down. You know what I'm saying? Scarlett held it all the way down, which was beautiful. I was on the boat last week and I got to tune in and watch. And I'm incredibly proud of Scarlett. Not only on Morning Coffee, but also holding it down later in the day with that conversation with Troy Carter. Can't wait to watch the recap on that because I know it was super thorough. But we back at it. We back at it. We here. And you know we got to do our quick roll call. Who's in the building? The squad is here. First and foremost, we got the guy himself. What up, Miles?
What's good, man? How you been? How you been? It's been a minute since we've been talking in this element. How you been?
It has been a minute. Man, I'm still waking up. I'm going to be honest. You know what I'm saying? Wake it up, wake it up. I'm telling that to myself. Yeah. But I feel good.
That's
I feel
good.
You know, we also got Izzy in this thing. What up, Iz?
Hi.
And, man, it's been a little minute since we had a segment with Izzy, so we get to get back to that today. Glad you're here. We got Fiction Frank in the building, you know, out here on the boards. And we got Ayo Cannon. Cannon is in here.
Yeah.
Riley is in here. Scarlett is in here. Yeah. It's a whole team affair. But we got to see, most importantly, who's in the chat. You know what I'm saying? It's a handful of us folks in here. We got to see what's going on with y'all. Let us know how y'all feeling. You know what I'm saying? Y'all getting your coffee in yet, you know? And where y'all at with it? Where y'all watching the show from? Always let it hear where the folks is at with it. So let us know. You know, we'll get that chat rolling. But, Miles, you know we be having themes of the day and all that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. We got a good one this week.
We do. What's the theme of the day, Miles? What are we talking about?
We're talking about resilience, man. Resilience.
That is a great one. Man. And, you know, when I think about resilience, I think that's like one of those underrated soft skills, you know, that we'd be talking about. And for me, I think resilience is such an important factor in success, right? Because I think, like, resilience is this idea of being able to, like, run into friction, run into walls, get denied, right? Get turned down for things and be able to keep going with the same level of enthusiasm. You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. And I think that's just a natural part of the journey. You know, I think sometimes we think that failure is the opposite of success.
Facts.
But I've learned that failure is really a part of the process to success. And I think resilience is one of those things that really, you know, sets apart the champions from the average.
I agree. And especially being like in the creative space that we're in, I think the great creators, the great entrepreneurs, they're the ones that embrace this topic of resilience. They're the ones that when they get knocked down, it's like they don't cry about it and soak about it. Like, all right, I'm gonna figure out a way to bounce back and overcome whatever it is. Even if I did take an L, it's not a loss, it's a lesson. We're gonna continue to move forward.
That's right. It's almost like that whole Rocky idea, right? You know, me and Philly. That whole Rocky movie is about resilience.
Exactly.
For real. And, like, I think there's a line Sylvester Stallone says. He's like, it's not about not getting hit. It's about how hard can you get hit and still keep moving forward.
Yeah, I agree 100%. Yeah. You've been on this creative journey for a long time. We're on the show. We're talking about creative entrepreneurship.
Yes, I'm just
interested about a couple of times that along your journey you got punched in the mouth, hit the canvas, maybe you had to bounce back up and continue going to make the thing we're doing now work, be a go, and be a leader in the space that we're in now.
Plenty, man. Plenty. Resilience is something that's a close part of who I am, right? And at first, I'm going to flip it and throw the question of the day out there for y'all. You know, like this chat up. Let us know what you think. But I want to know, when is a time that you felt like you had to be resilient? You know, let's switch that question up just a little bit. Let's frame it up this way. When is the time that you remember where you really had to be resilient? You know what I mean? It's a safe space. It's a brave space. Let us know. You know, we try. We all in here together. I want to know specifically, like, what's something that you were navigating where you really had to turn on the resilience muscle? And I got to say what's up to some of the homies in the chat. You know, I see Nairobi in this thing. Peace, peace, peace. She says she's feeling immortal.
Oh, I need that energy.
Energy. Immortal. I love that. Welcome. Welcome. Glad you're here. Linda's in this joint. What's up, Linda? Actually, if that's the Linda that I know, it's actually Linday. Maybe. Depends. Might be a different one. But if it's you, what's up, Linday? Let's make sure you're pronouncing that right. And then we also got Jay Cruz 4K. What's up, Jay? Peace, peace, peace. Renee in this thing. What's good? What's good? But yeah, Miles, you asked me a question, man, about, you know, resilience, you know, on my journey. You know, on the micro, I'm not going to front. This week has been a resilience journey for me. I've been traveling a lot, so, like, I don't know why, but I have not been sleeping well. I think it's because, like, I have, like, a million tabs open in my brain, and, like, there's so much going on that I would just be, I don't know, racking my brain in different ways, and it's hard for me to fall asleep. So waking up this morning, I was like, ugh. So I think that's the micro resilience, like, still being able to just, like, move forward and get done what you got to get done, even when you're not feeling 100, right? Like, waiting to feel good or waiting for the perfect time for something is, like, really not the way. So sometimes you got to just turn it on. But in the macro, fundraising has been a resilience exercise, man. And not just, you know, this time, but even in the beginning, you know, like, I always tell this story, but we had so many no's, you know, before we got the first yes. So even right now, we're back on the fundraising journey again. We're raising money to continue to grow REC, to continue to build our technology. And that is the exact example of what resilience looks like. We're like, literally, you got to look people in the face, ask for the bread. Sometimes they say yes. Most times they say no, but still being able to go into the next conversation with that same level of, like, confidence, that same level of energy, that same level of pride, right? So that's what resilience has been looking like for me lately. But how about you, man? Is there a time that comes to mind for you when you think about when you had to be resilient?
Yeah, I guess just, like, being a creative in general, when you're trying to build something of your own, and you try to get people to see what you're building at the end of the day, and it's like some people not see it right away, so it may put you down. Or like you said, when you're going to fundraising, you try to get people to help you out on your journey, and they say, nah, I'm not really seeing what you got going on. I've experienced that on a lower level for sure, like just having people along to help me build what I'm trying to build, whether it's in the media space, whether it's in the podcasting space, that type of thing, and just trying to, I guess, get people on the same wavelength to see, like, the bigger picture.
Yeah,
it's hard a lot of the times. It's hard, and I think that's anybody can, any creative can deal with that. Like, we have Izzy in here. She's a video creator, content creator, mm-hmm. does multiple things. We have Frank in here. They all can probably attest to times in their life where they tried to get people to just understand that maybe even our career that we're trying to do in the creative space is a career that can actually happen.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying? And we've probably all heard people, oh, get a real job, do X, Y, and Z, and having to just deal with that on a daily basis.
And I think what you're hinting at there that I'm picking up on is, like, that superpower underneath resilience is really, like, that self-belief.
Yeah.
Right? And, like, if you don't believe that you can overcome the thing, then it's really hard to be resilient and stand in the temporary failures.
Yeah.
That's a good one. And from the homies, you know, the homies are saying, man, am I reading this? She said, yeah, Nairobi said she got hit with a $14,000 lawsuit, but she won. You know what I'm saying? Brum, brum, brum. Because that's ugly. You know what I'm saying? Getting sued is crazy. You know, that's a part of the game that you don't hope happens.
Right.
You hope you never have to know what that's like.
14K ain't a small number either. For
it's me. Not. That could be detrimental.
Yeah.
You know, so I'm grateful that you got through that. And hopefully, you know, you learn some things about yourself, you know, that you could take with you. So yes, it is Linday. What's up, Linday? Period. What up? Resilience with mental blocks. Mm. She said, sometimes we are our biggest obstacle to press through. That's the truth.
Yeah.
You know, and I think it's big and small, right? Sometimes, like, resilience looks like you put your heart, soul, and mind and creative journey into building a thing, a piece of content, and then you publish it.
Yeah.
And then it don't get the response that you wanted.
Exactly.
And you have to have the same confidence to show up again the next day and post again, right? Create again. So I could feel that.
What do you say to creators that feel that they don't get the response that they get if it's only, like, because you know when you drop something, you're expecting to see, like, oh, the love and joy, and then to understand, like, the time and effort you put into something, but when you post it or whatever, it gets maybe a couple likes, a couple comments. Like, what would you say to a creator that's feeling that way?
Keep going. Keep going. I heard someone say this the other day. They were like, yo, you got to remember that this project's about the next project. Mm. I was like, what do you mean? And they were like, every project you do should really be a learning lesson to make your next project better. So at that point, it's like, it's never about this one grand thing, right? And then you get disappointed. It's like, yo, it's about the process, right? It's about getting used to creating, getting used to putting things out, getting used to getting that feedback.
Yeah.
So I think that's the best perspective to have.
That's a dope perspective. I never really thought about it that way, but that's nice.
They said there's no loss. There's no L's because this project's about the next project.
That's dope.
So, and one other thing I want to say about this idea of resilience before we go into industry news is when I think about resilience, I tend to think about the idea of struggle. You know what I'm saying? And I think there's this real beautiful power in the idea of productive struggle, right? Because I think resilience is a muscle, and I think struggle is what builds it, right? In the gym, right? You don't, if you're going like this and getting all this weight up, you're not actually working out or growing while it's easy. You only actually start working out when you have to struggle, right? And I think that if we try to live our lives in a way that we avoid struggle, we avoid pain, it doesn't allow us to actually grow the muscle. So when real struggle, like the struggle we can't predict, the struggle we don't actually want, we won't be prepared to handle it. So I think like there's something beautiful about choosing the struggle, embracing struggle, and knowing that it's the most constructive thing that you can do sometimes. And my homie Carlos, he's a rec member. He runs a company called We Love Philly. Mm-hmm. And his whole thing is like, life is a beautiful struggle. Like, embrace the suck.
Yeah.
Right? And he be going crazy. Like, this bull, you know, he raised money for charity by walking from Philadelphia to Atlantic City.
Wow.
Right? Like, I'm like, why would you do that, bro? But what he's doing, he's, like, fortifying his mind of, like, I could do anything. Mm-hmm. Right? So the next time, hopefully it's not actually having to walk that distance.
That's a distance.
But the next time you have to do something really hard, it's like, I've done hard things before, you know? And I think that's something that is a gift, you know. If you come from an environment where you had to grow up struggling, there's a superpower in that because it prepares you, you know, to not be at your lowest low just because something's difficult.
So based on that, do you believe struggle is necessary for growth?
Absolutely, without a doubt. I don't think there is growth without struggle. You know, like, rarely have I ever seen someone, like, be amazing at something on the first time.
Right.
Like, you might be good, you might get the beginner's luck, but you're not going to be amazing. Mm-hmm. So it's like, to be great, the precursor is to be good, and the precursor to that is to be, like, bad.
Right.
And it's like, how confident can you stay while you're bad? How much belief do you have in yourself while you're trash to actually know that, like, eventually you won't be trash?
Right.
You know? So, yeah, I think struggle is super important. And that's why I think sometimes when, like, if you come from money, that's a blessing. But also it can become a curse if you didn't earn it and work for it because you don't have the skills, right, or the desire that's just in you to, like, want to go after it.
Yeah.
So it actually becomes really crippling for a lot of people.
I agree.
You know?
I agree with that.
So I see the chat is rolling. Let me see what our folks are saying. Create again. So true. Jay Crew says, if you are not getting either the love or the knowledge from producing and creating art, then it means you are not asking for enough feedback. Yes. And I'm not going to cap, Jay. Sometimes as a creative, asking for feedback is the hardest thing ever.
Yeah.
Right? Because then you open yourself up, right, for that pain of like, oh, it wasn't perfect. It wasn't amazing, right? But you're right. All that growth comes from being able to take that feedback. And I think it's a rare type of human who actually seeks out the feedback.
Right.
You know? But those are people who become unstoppable.
How do you decipher, like, what's good feedback and bad feedback, though?
Discernment. Discernment, right? I guess you got to take into consideration who's giving it to you and what level of expertise they have.
Right.
Right? Because, for example, there's, like, the expert feedback of, like, oh, here's my mentor that's seen and done this thing before, so therefore they have a good place to stand on when they tell me that something is right or not right.
Mm-hmm.
But other feedback is, like, I made a product for the market and nobody bought it.
Yeah.
And the feedback I'm getting is people don't want this thing.
Exactly.
Right? So I think you just have to have discernment of knowing, like, okay, what kind of feedback is this? Is it valid or not? And can I trust the source? But that's just a discernment skill. You know, I don't have a whole philosophy or
nah, for sure. I was just curious.
Of that. But that's how I think about it. What else we got in the chat? Nairobi said she learned that people don't always bet on the fact that they have a valid case against you. They bet on you being too ignorant to know better. She said, mostly because you're black. She said, but I'm a genius, though. Yo, the energy. Nairobi got the energy. I respect it. I respect it. Wow, Riley said, can you really be good at what you're doing if you didn't struggle? Struggle is wisdom. That's right. Nipsey said it. You know, you don't skip the steps because then you'll also miss the lessons.
Facts.
That's what's up. Yo, Miyako is in the building. What's up, Miyako?
Shout out, Miyako.
Yeah, I'm saying blessed morning to you, bro. Blessed morning. Jason, beauty in the struggle. Yes, sir. You know the vibes. Regina in here. Selecta in here. Oh, it's okay. The home team is back. You know what I mean? We appreciate y'all tuning in. Let us know if you just pulled up. The question of the day is, when is the time that you had to be resilient? You know what I'm saying? We want to hear about it. Also, we want to know what you learned from it. You know, how that's shown up for you, because that's a part of the grind. Cal is in the building. What's up, Cal? Peace. All right, cool. So let's keep it pushing. Miles, we got some really interesting industry news today.
Yeah, there's a lot of interesting topics today.
Yeah, and before we get into it, yo, listen, appreciate y'all being here. Do us a quick favor. Make sure y'all like this video. If you haven't already, make sure you're subscribing to the Rec Philly YouTube channel. And if you enjoy morning coffee, yeah, you know I'm saying cheers to you. And make sure you're sharing this video with other people. You know, we want to make sure we get to grow this community. We want to grow the show. So you can help us do that by liking, commenting, subscribing, all that fun stuff. And, of course, sharing. Yeah, we're real YouTubers now, so we have to say that stuff. It's a part of it. It's a part of it. All right. Excuse me. Industry news. Wait, did we roll the industry news? Let's do it. Let's transition. Check. Pow. We back. All right. Industry news. And just so y'all know, you see it on the screen. At the end of the segment, we're going to give away some free coffee. I didn't switch up my coffee. I have like a very specific order. But today we doing a dirty chai. You know what I'm saying? So maybe you want to try a dirty chai. You want that in your life.
Is that your go-to?
Nah, my go-to is something different. But today, it's the dirty chai. It's my backup. Okay. I wanted to switch it up. And it's about to be summertime. I feel that way, so I got the iced dirty chai.
Okay.
So if you need an iced dirty chai in your life, we gonna do that on us, right? At the end of the segment, we'll give it away, so stick around. I want to start off with this one, because this one is crazy to me. Mm-hmm. And it's been rumored for a little while. But I'm going to pull up an article, because I want to read this, want to make sure I get it right. MSNBC, headline, Elon Musk's brain implant company Neuralink announces FDA approval of in-human clinical study. What that mean? That means that Neuralink, right? This Elon's vision is to be able to create these chips and put them in your brain, right? So literally you can do things with your thoughts, right? You can think things and, you know, and I'll read it because I don't want to get these. You know what? Yeah, let's show it on the screen. Let's show the folks what we're talking about. Boom, right here, Neuralink. Neuralink, the neurotech startup co-founded by Elon Musk, announced Thursday that it has received approval from the FDA, the Food and Drug Administration, can conduct its first in-human clinical studies. The implant aims to help patients with severe paralysis regain their ability to communicate by controlling external technologies using only neural signals. For example, I'm an amputee, right, and I can't control my legs. But now I can think about moving my legs, and it will send a brainwave to these artificial legs and move them. Different, right? The extent of the approved trial is not known, but Neuralink said in a tweet that patient recruitment for its clinical trials is not open yet. But I'm wondering, when it is open, Miles, are you going to sign up for the Neuralink trials?
The Neuralink joint?
You know what I'm saying? You getting the chip?
I mean, if I'm trying to advance the way I think and move, maybe. Get the chip in my brain.
I'm not putting
a chip in my brain.
You going to be an early adopter?
Not an early adopter. That's why.
I'd say you bold. You know what I'm saying? But listen, do you.
I'll probably have to wait a couple years before they do the test trials, the first waves get out the way. Then maybe, you know what I'm saying? Maybe.
It's crazy.
What about you? What you going to do?
I'm good for a little bit. I might be in the late majority of this one.
He said the late majority.
You know what I'm saying? I'm not sprinting to get something put in my brain. Because I'm going to say this. Like, what's interesting to me is I think the use case that they're outlining of, like, yo, maybe you have these disabilities and deficiencies that then require you to have something like this to offset your just ability to live life regularly. That's beautiful. For sure. But I personally believe that Elon Musk is really trying to just get to superhuman status.
Yeah, 100%.
And just, you know what I'm saying? And just have us actually just be able to level up and Internet of Things from our brain, right? Think this. And now just imagine having that chip. Chat GPT is on this, John, right? Like, you just on some bionic.
Yeah.
You know, what's that? Terminator type vibe.
You said the Terminator type vibe.
Real talk. Like, that's how I feel. But I want to know, in the chat, let us know, what do y'all think about Neuralink? Y'all dig it? Are y'all afraid of it? Is it the inevitable technology, or is this the line of doing too much? Scarlett said it's already happening. What do you mean? Expand. Oh, yo. My trip I was on last week, everybody had one of them, Jones.
Had a move ring?
Ooh rings.
Ooh rings?
Yeah.
What's that?
That's crazy.
Wow.
So a lot of people use them for, like, tracking their vitals and stuff. Like, instead of wearing an Apple Watch, you have this ring on, and it tells you, like, your vital signs. It'll tell you, like, how well you slept and, like, all these, like, just specific data points about your optimization. Mm-hmm. It tells you, like, how charged your body is, like, all these things. But putting it in your brain, though, I could take the ring off. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? But, like, when they be like, all right, see you later.
So will it be like... Would it be like, that's crazy.
Yo, Scarlett. Yo, y'all don't hear these side jokes from Scarlett. Yeah, Scarlett's hilarious.
But I was going to say, is it something you're going to actually, like, implant into your brain? It's going to be like a chip that just you can stick to your temple or that type of thing.
It's a chip. Look, Neuralink is a part of the emerging brain-computer interface or BCI industry. Yeah. A BCI is a system that deciphers brain signals and translate them into commands for external technologies. Neuralink's the best known one, obviously, because of the profile of Elon Musk. But yes, the idea is there's a chip that they put in your brain that allows you to tap into real neurons or whatever they celluloids and make-believes. I don't know. I'm not a brain scientist.
Nah, for sure.
But they put the chip in your brain. So what do y'all think? I'm scared. You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to be lining up to get this. But, you know, what's up?
But if everything's approved, let's say 20, 25 years, million people have tested it. Would you try it? Because I think one thing that we're overlooking right now, Elon Musk's initial explanation for this, and I'm not defending it. I'm probably not going to do it, but the idea was that the way we are kind of already cyborgs now because we hold phones all the time, and we rely on that for information. Like, that's a standard no one can argue with. And he described it as we're consuming information through a straw right now. That cyborg extent.
He's about to give us the hose
in our head. We won't have to take that time to, of course, Google, but then also read and, like, process.
Because the reading is slow.
It is. It's just a hindrance. You know, I mean, there's stuff we did in high school and college, like the books we didn't read. We would go on them tab websites or whatever to write essays quick. Like, what do you think about that? Would you do, SparkNotes.
Yeah.
I've used it, like, twice.
Look, so.
But would you do it with all those things considered?
With all those things considered. I'm in the late majority, right? When I'm like the green bubble in the group chat and all my homies got it and I'm like the last guy. Okay. At that point and I see them living lives, then maybe. Fair. But like my computer still crashes every now and then.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like you gonna put it in my brain? You know what I'm saying? Like I think technology is amazing until it's not. And I think there's a trust issue of like, imagine if you hacked somebody's brain.
Oh, that's crazy.
Right? All of a sudden, they can't control themselves, and they just doing things. I'm a little shy about that.
You said that the crashing, like, what if it does crash your brain? Like, the whole thing just drops dead or whatever. You have to go, like, Apple Store, you have to go get it fixed.
Where's Will? Oh, yeah, his Neuralink crashed. Crazy. What? It's like, is it worth it? I don't know. I don't know. But at the same time, like, I can't act like I'm holier than thou. I got the vax, yeah. Right? Some people were scared of the vax, right? And we're not gonna talk about the vax. But but you know, chipping your brain is crazy.
I'll put a different perspective on it.
Maybe I just have something around control.
Yeah, the control thing is definitely scary.
Maybe I gotta work through that in therapy. I don't know.
Yeah, for sure. And I'll give a different perspective because I experienced.
You can pull that, Frank.
Because I've experienced, like, I have nerve damage, so I've experienced it. So, like, I'm thinking of a perspective of someone that maybe lost, like, they're not being able to use their limbs, yes. Things of that nature. And, like, yes. This may be, like, a light of hope for them to be able to experience that again. Like, say someone experienced, they were born, they were able to use all their limbs, they got an accident, mm-hmm. And now they're confined to a wheelchair.
Yes.
Like, now I have hope to be able to maybe walk again.
I think in that scenario, do it.
Yeah.
You know, if it can bring you back quality of life.
Exactly.
But I think if you are an able-bodied person and you're doing this to, like, supplement.
Oh, yeah, that's wild.
Then I think it's different. If it's, like, on some designer shit, right? Like, it's different than, like, you know? So, but let's see. Let's see what the folks in the chat is saying. Crazy. They said, put that chip in you is crazy. Nicole Glass says she'd do it for a half a mil. You know what I'm saying? I get it.
Half a mil might be too low.
Everybody got a number. You know what I'm saying? What's your number, Miles? They put the cash up. They said, listen, we got a million for you. You doing it?
A million not enough.
A million's not enough?
A million not enough.
Two million?
I need like five. Because you just scared me with the, what if the chip crashes?
What if, like, all of a sudden,
you live on Morning Coffee and all of a sudden you just drop.
Start saying crazy stuff. That's not even Will. Yo, I need to know, what's y'all number? Drop y'all number in the chat, right? These clinical trials go out and they saying, yo, we gonna pay people in cash to be the test dummies. What's your number? How big of a bag do you need to confidently walk in there, right? And there's a crazy show. There's a show, I think it's on Apple.
I know what you're talking about.
You know what I'm talking about? Exactly. It's like you lit. Severance is crazy.
Yeah, I'm
you watch Severance, Scarlett?
Yep. Solid.
And basically the concept is like they do something to your brain, mm-hmm. where like your everyday walking life is you walk into your job, yep. And then it like wipes all your memory and then you only know what you know from being in the job.
Yeah.
And while you're in the job, you have no idea about your life outside the job. That's brazy, and I feel like we're about to get there. What's
it
up?
It takes work wife and work husband to like a whole nother level.
Hey, yo. It's everything is fair game at that point. You're like, I don't even remember Shorty.
In the show, yeah.
That's crazy. Wow. So check out Severance if y'all haven't seen it.
That's funny.
I feel like that was Elon's way of like soft launching Neuralink coming. You know what I'm saying? Hey, Scarlett is crazy.
Yo, now, look what Nairobi said. That's funny.
What'd she say? Let me look. Oh, I think I might have missed it. What'd she say?
She said, nope, no number is high enough. Might volunteer one of my cousins, though.
Hey, yo. Not sacrificing the loved ones. Fair enough. Look, man. And Riley said, they're going to make you pay half a mil, and people are going to line up for it. Yo, for real. Like, at a certain point, when it's tested, people, I think, will pay big money for this. Renee said, they got to pay off her student loans and give her 5 mil on top. I respect it.
How long do you think before it's like a common thing that we have this chip in our brain? Because you see TV shows and stuff like insinuating and foreshadowing this stuff about to happen. So like how long before it's actually a reality for everyone?
Over under 20 years. You know what I'm saying? I think 20 years, we chipped up.
We chipped
up. Which ain't that far away.
It's not far.
It's not far away at all. But that's what I think. I don't know. What you think? What's your bet? How long?
I say 2025.
Yeah.
Before it's a common thing to see people like.
Wait, 2025?
No, like 20.
Oh,
20 to 25 okay. years.
I'm about to say, hold on.
No, not 2 years from now. Not 2 years from now.
You signing up.
He said you signed up.
And at that point, are they just chipping babies? Whoa. Right? Like, are you born and then you just get chipped and then it's like, that's all I know? Wow. Like a circumcision. Yo, Scarlett is nuts. You get snipped and you get chipped. All in one flow. That's crazy. Shout out Elon Musk. He's a wild boy. Man.
Snip and chip. All right. Yo, that's wild.
That's Neuralink. Let's move on. Oh, man. What a show.
TM.
Got the good old chip and snip. The snip and chip. Wow. All right. So Yeah, sign up, sign your babies up for the snip and chip coming to a hospital near you. Shout out Elon Musk. What else we got? Wow, crazy shift gears. Roots Picnic is coming up.
Talk about it. Talk about a snip and chip.
Oh, y'all are nuts, yo. You got me on here crying. So the Roots Picnic is coming up, which is a whole vibe. Bittersweet. I'm a little upset. We heard this. Excuse me. We heard this past week. The homie Diddy is not going to be performing at the Roots Picnic. Where my womp? There we go. I was really looking forward to it. I guess he decided to stay in album mode. He got that album coming. But they replaced him with Usher. Uh-oh. Boom. Ah. Scarlett said we all got to get our Usher bucks ready. You know what I'm saying? Like Yo, Usher's Tiny Desk?
Classic.
Top tier. Top five. I will put it in the top five. Right up there with T-Pain. Right up there with T-Pain and Mac Miller and Tyler, the Creators. Amazing. But the Roots Picnic lineup is crazy. Frank, why don't you just put this on the screen right quick? If y'all in the Philly area and you're not going to the Roots Picnic, you sleep. I went last year and the year before, and they've been really, really special. Lineup is stacked. Miles, who your favorite picks? Give me three artists that you excited to see at the Roots Picnic. Let me know.
I want to see, I like Lauryn Hill, obviously.
For sure.
Yeah, I hope she shows up, but Lauryn Hill.
Hey, not I hope she shows up.
I think the Isley Brothers are on there.
Yo, you heard that new album?
I haven't yet, but I need to tap in.
Isley Brothers featuring 2 Chainz? Just saying, it's a thing.
And then Usher, now he's there. Usher, I want to see Usher live. That'd be a vibe.
Fair enough. You know who my number one is right now?
Who?
Uncle Waffles.
Uncle Waffles.
Y'all know about Uncle Waffles? Game changer. Uncle Waffles, amazing DJ out of South Africa. She is going to bring it. I'm telling you right now, it's going to be the best performance of the day. She's a beast. And, hold on, Select is still in the chat. After party at Nodo, Uncle Waffles, DJ Nash, and Selecta.
That's crazy.
Nuts. So I'm just saying, don't play yourself and miss that, John. Selecta, what's up? What should we expect? Let us know in the chat. Selecta, and which day? Let us know. Which day of the Roots Picnic are y'all going crazy with that after party? Because I'm going to be there in rare form. If you see me standing on a couch in a club, it might be one of the very few times. Don't judge me.
I ain't going to hold you. I need to see that Ari Lennox set, too.
Oh, that's going
to
be fire.
I need to see the Ari Lennox set.
That's going to be good. And then the State Prop reunion.
Yeah.
On the Roots Picnic stage, that's going to be a moment.
Energy going to be crazy.
Yeah, you know I'm saying? I heard Ayo Cannon got media passes and photo passes. He about to be snapping it up.
Hey.
You know? And shout out to Rec. You know, we ended up putting a bunch of members on to have media access at this John. So that's a special thing. If you don't be opening those digests, you don't be on the app looking at the opportunity board, you're playing yourself because we putting people in real position. So that's going to be dope. But, yeah, Roots Picnic is coming up. Make sure y'all get y'all tickets. That's going to be a great thing. Let's keep it pushing. They remaking The Color Purple, bro.
Yeah, they remaking The Color Purple. We've seen a lot of mixed reviews, man. A lot of mixed reviews.
It's a fact. What do you think about it? What do you think about The Color Purple, John?
With this movie specifically, I don't think it needed to be touched, personally.
Mm.
I think this is like a classic one where like you could, like, my parents showed me The Color Purple before. Like, yeah. I feel like that's just, you can something, and Frank was talking about this earlier, some movies just don't need to be remade. You can just go back and show them the classic version because it's just a staple and when it was made, that type of thing.
Okay.
What's your perspective on it?
So I watched the trailer, right? And one, shout out to the Bailey sisters running it up.
They're killing it.
Hallie just had the Little Mermaid, and now she's doing The Color Purple. Crazy. The cast is stacked.
Yeah.
And Oprah's producing it, Spielberg's directing again, right? So that's that dream team staying in place.
Sure.
I just say, I hope it's great, you know? Because I do think, I'll say this, my opinion on remake culture is I think sometimes you have to remake something and update it to make it relevant to the next generation.
Uh-huh.
And I felt that way about Top Gun. Have y'all seen Top Gun?
Yeah, Top Gun was very good.
So I had never seen the original, and I watched that new John, and I was like, yo, this is fire. And that made me actually want to go back. And I was like, dang, I missed out on a really great story.
Mm-hmm.
And I think, you know, in my mind, I would imagine that Gen Z don't really know about The Color Purple like that.
They don't.
So I would hope that this makes them reach back, you know. And
Do you think some stories, though, and some storylines stand the test of time, though? Like where you don't need to remake it?
I think that's what makes it a classic. Yeah, I think that's what makes it a classic. But I kind of wonder, like, to me, the trailer didn't make me feel like it's going to be the exact same story.
Yeah, I think it's going to be more like musically inclined. It's going to be like a musical type version, I think, where it's going to be like singing and stuff in there, that type of thing.
And I don't know, I'm a little uninformed, but the original one, didn't it go on Broadway? Color Purple? Like, yeah. So it's kind of, so they're kind of mixing the Broadway element with the
exactly.
film.
Exactly. Yep.
Okay. So yeah, I don't know what to expect, but I'm okay with it. I feel like they're going to do it with care.
Oh, for sure. I think it's definitely going to be done like with care, cuz you said the producers on it, mm-hmm. like they were part of the original movie.
Yep.
So it's obviously going to be done with care, but like I said, I'm a proponent of like some stuff doesn't need to be remade, but other things do need to be remade.
That's right. But yeah, Color Purple is a classic. So, let's see if they do it right. All right, moving on to the next thing. Our guy Puff, Diddy launches Diddy Direct.
Mm-hmm.
And I think this is pretty fly. In short, if you haven't heard, if you haven't seen the launch commercial with him and DJ Khaled, Puff just built a whole new business, specifically making sure that both retailers and consumers have direct access to his spirit products, right? So the idea of, like, you go to your wine and spirits and they don't have that flavor Ciroc you want, or they don't have that De Leon Reposado, you can literally go onto the website and have them ship it out to you, or ship it out to your nearest wine and spirits. He's just trying to cut out the middleman in all the ways.
Yeah.
And I think that's brilliant. I think when you get to, you know, building really, really profitable brands, you start to think about how you can cut costs further. And I think he's about to really, like, one, take away any excuse for people not to get the product.
Exactly.
And two, I think this is going to increase that bottom line. So I'm interested to see where this goes. But I love seeing people at his level thinking about direct-to-consumer.
When it comes to direct-to-consumer, I read a little bit about this. Is it so is this going to be like his own platform that he has where they can just go in and buy whatever they want, like you said, and ship it? Or is this like there's still going to be like another third-party thing that they have to go through to make sure the things get there? You know how you go to Amazon, you can buy a product of maybe mm-hmm. who it is, or it's going to be his own like platform that he has?
Frank, you mind pulling this up? Let's pull up DiddyDirect.com. You know what I'm saying? Here it is. Are you over 21? We are. You know, retailer or consumer. So as a retailer, okay, so state is really important. And we're going to say Florida right now because...
So you want anything to happen.
Just because I know the laws are different in PA. PA is, oh, nothing here yet. Oh, yeah, I was born before then. 2000. Whoa, people born in 2002 can drink?
Yeah. 2002, it's crazy. Hold on.
Where is the Twilight Zone?
You said the Twilight Zone.
That's not even the Twilight Zone. That's crazy to me. But here's what I think. You could pull that, Frank. Here's what I think. I think what it's shaping up to be is if I'm in Florida, a state where, like, they can deliver liquor, right? In PA, you can't do that. But, like, GoPuff in Florida can deliver you liquor.
Yeah.
Right? So I think if you're like, hey, this is where I'm at, this is what I need, whatever delivery service will then bring it to you.
Gotcha.
So it still has a slight middleman thing, uh-huh. but it gives you the ability to just be like, send my stuff.
I like that. I agree with that. I like what he's doing.
Yeah. And then on the retailer side, right, if you like own a private liquor store or something, or your wine and spirits, I think you would have to have a relationship with the distributor. Mm. But now I think you can literally just get it right from Puff. From a retailer standpoint.
Yeah, what I was translating it to is like, you remember the early like t-shirt making days, you know, like everybody would either go to a local screen printing shop or to like customizeinkshirt.com, which was like a giant retailer.
Yeah.
Now I see what he's trying to do is make it so that you can actually optimize that experience. Mm-hmm. And I actually wanted to ask you on the back of it, kind of like Amazon motivates us to buy things because they're cheaper. It's going to come in the same day. We go to Walmart, maybe something might not be there that we need from the house.
Yep.
But also, sometimes they give you incentives like, oh, now you get free shipping on anything else you order for today.
Yeah.
What's a way that you think Diddy might make us want to order alcohol online and get it shipped to our house? Because this is a new experience.
That's a good question. You know, I don't know if I've thought about the value proposition outside of the convenience yet. You know, I think the convenience is the main one. If he starts saying it's going to be cheaper, right? Like, I think that's, you know, like, oh, buy a case and now all of a sudden you save 30% or something. Like, I think people would do that.
Sure.
And he can afford that, right? Because, again, he's cutting out one of the middlemen in a certain way. So, yeah, it's interesting. I'm going to keep, you know, following it and seeing where it goes. But I think this is really interesting. And I wonder if other retailers, celebrity retailers would do the same, like, you know, Terramina with The Rock and, you know, all of the others. So, super interesting, worth watching. Yeah, try it. I know the new Ciroc Honey Melon. It's fire. I don't even really like vodka like that, but that one's good. Might be the taste of the summer. Who knows?
Taste of the summer.
Cool. So that's the industry news. I think that's good. We spent a lot of time on Elon and Snip and Chip.
It might be the title of this episode. Snip and Chip.
You heard it first here. Snip and Chip, y'all. Get it done. All right, cool. So let's give away some coffee. Listen, y'all, go ahead, throw those cash tags in the chat. We about to bless somebody with some coffee. You know, get your iced chai, you know, the dirty chai vibes. That's what I'm doing. You know what? One more industry news I want to tell everyone about. Yo, telling y'all right now, we kicking off the summer in full effect. Frank, throw this on the screen for me, please. Cosmic Rhythms. If y'all have not been to a Cosmic Rhythms yet, Joshua Lang, DJ Silo, together they are BWC Sounds. It's at Cherry Street Pier. It's going to be nuts. I think if you are anywhere remotely close to Philadelphia or the surrounding tri-state area, you should be at this party. It's just a vibe. And, you know, they playing soul, funk, house music. And for me, I think this is like the initial launch of the summer. You know what I mean? They got me switching from hot coffee to iced coffee.
Yeah.
You know, it's that vibe. The sun is out. So I'm going to be there, you know. I hope to see y'all there. But I just want to show some love. Shout out Josh. Shout out, you know, the homie Silo. It's up. Don't miss this, John, because it's going to be super special. All right, cool. You can pull that. Frank, what the folks saying? Y'all dropping those cash tags? They are. Okay, lit. Cool. We'll be sure to bless somebody with a good old coffee. All right, let's transition. We got a new segment for y'all. Let's go ahead and get to it. Boom. Burr, burr, burr. Whew. Let's get it. Resource of the day. Resource of the day. Are you going to go right there? Yeah, bring me in. So look, before we get to the Ant's video, I want to talk about this resource of the day. We talking about fireflies.ai. Y'all know we love to talk about AI on this show because AI is the future. I am not endorsing y'all to go get the Neuralink, but I am endorsing y'all to figure out what AI tools can level up your productivity. And one of the ones that are out on the market right now are these AI tools specifically. Hold on. I just saw something in the chat that I didn't know about. I was just made aware. We gonna come back to this AI tool. My man Joshua Lang is in the chat. Welcome, Josh. And he said, special guest at the John this Saturday, Rich Medina. That's fire. That's a whole legend right there. Rich is about to be in his bag. And I got to just tell this quick story. Live updates on the show.
I love it.
World premiere. You know what I'm saying? So when I was on the boat at Summit at Sea, Rich was on the boat, and there was a really beautiful moment. Rich has been a legend, right, in the space, DJing for probably like 30 years, you know what I mean, at the highest levels. And they took some time to give Rich his flowers while he was on the boat, like literally, like in the middle of a set, he had no idea. People started giving him the flowers, and the homie Arturo Nunez gave him a toast. And I seen my man Rich Medina really shed some thug tears. And it was so beautiful because I think DJs don't really be getting their just due, you know what I mean, for how powerful they are in the spaces that they occupy.
Right.
So shout out Rich Medina. I can't wait to see him back in Philly zone. Shout out Josh for just letting us know that that's going down. That's going to be super, super special. John Jukebox, another great DJ, said he's been meaning to see Rich Medina for a while, so this is a blessing. Yes, you know, it's going to be one of them ones. So shout out him.
DJs move the culture, man.
Talk about it.
DJs move the culture.
DJs really do. You
don't get enough credit for it, like you said.
They don't. So, yeah, it was really good to see him get honored in that way and to know that he's about to be at this event. Because I look at Silo and Josh as, like, the new vanguard of DJs, you know what I'm saying, in a certain regard. So seeing someone so dope as a legend like Rich being a part of that mix, too, is fire. It's almost like a passing of the torch, in my opinion, you know. But anyway, let's go back to AI. I got excited. I saw that in the chat, and I couldn't moonwalk over that. So anyway, there's a bunch of these tools. We're talking about the resource of the day. Specifically, there are some AI tools that are developing specifically to automate meeting notes, right? So if y'all are having all these meetings with these different people, sometimes it's hard to keep up with everything that's being said, to take really efficient notes. So sometimes you'll have an assistant or someone else in there to help take notes for you on your behalf and things like that. But now AI is coming through. There's platforms like Fireflies, if you want to show this one to him, Frank. There's platforms like Otter that's on the market. And essentially speed up your workflow. And it's like, not only do these things like just transcribe what's being said and give you like the rundown, but I've even seen these drones, some of them start to like analyze what's being said, right? Paraphrase what's being said and like give you sections of the notes of like, okay, in the beginning, y'all talked about this and who's going to do that. Here are some to-dos, all these things. So it's super fascinating. Like literally it'll tell you down here, boom, tasks, dates and times, metrics discussed, questions, pricing, tell you how many filler words, you know, you had in a certain part of the meeting. It's really, really powerful. So yeah, if you haven't checked these platforms out, go use them, see what's up. But Fireflies is just one of them. I do know that Otter.ai is another one. But yeah, let me know what y'all think. Are y'all using tools like this yet? Have y'all been leaning in? I know Chenille on our team over here at Rec, she uses it. She swears by it. And I'm starting to be convinced as well.
At this point, there's no reason for, if you're waiting to get started on something, there's no reason not to get started because you have all these tools nowadays to help you.
I agree.
So
I agree. Save yourself some time. Level up your productivity. AI. All right, cool. That's the resource of the day, y'all. Check out these AI tools. And what we're going to do now is we're going to shift. We got some more IRL resources that we want to talk about. So we're going to go ahead and cut it to my man, Ant, who's about to give us another room breakdown. So go ahead, tune in, check this out. We'll throw it over to him. And then the moment everyone's been waiting for, Scarlett gets back up here and does her thing. Good. So I'll be back.
What's going on? In a previous episode, I showed you guys the podcast room, WXPN podcast room. It's a really great room for more casual style podcasts. But I know some of you business professionals, you know, you're interviewing some important people. You want to be sitting at a desk. So that's what we made this room for. This is our collab room. We call it the green collab room because we have the wet grass right there. It's green. The really cool thing about this collab room, not only is it a place for you and your team to lock in, get some work done, you know, make progress on those to-dos, but it can double as a podcast studio. So right here, we have a Zoom H6, same exact unit that's in the podcast room that you use. So you slot your SD card in there. In this table, we have these mic cables ready to go. And these are already plugged into the Zoom, right? They're numbered on the Zoom as well as on the on the part where you put the mic in. So at the inventory desk, you just come up, you ask us for a couple of SM58s. Let us know that you're doing a podcast in here. We'll get you all set up. We have little mic stands as well as great vocal mics for you to get your podcast done. So this is for the more professional podcast. Also has a screen for you to take advantage of. You can cast your logo up there. You can put a background video on if you wanted to. Definitely a lot of room for branding there. And this room is modular. If you want to move it around, feel free. Ask the studio team first if you're going to do anything crazy. But I've seen people move this desk to be, you know, horizontal so that they get kind of like an across the table type style podcast. Whatever works for you. We have a rolling whiteboard there if you want to jot ideas down or, you know, write the topics that you're going to hit cover on your show. This is a great room, you know, not, like I said, not only for locking in and getting work done, but you can host a podcast in here as well. Next week, we'll take a look at some of the recording studios, and you'll be able to see what those look like. Back to you at the desk.
Girl, you know the vibes right now. I gotta fix this because it's not happening. But I'm super excited to be here in the Little Cafecito Corner. And if you don't know, we are here at Rec Resources for Every Creator, 10,000 square feet of creative spaces here in Philadelphia. Our job is to create opportunities, and we do it in everything that we do, including morning coffee and just highlighting our amazing community, because this is a space, the space is cool, but it's the people that really bring in the soul and all that good stuff. So I'm super excited to have Clint Coley here with me today.
Yeah, what's up?
Who is a phenomenally hard worker. I see him in here cutting it up every day because he has some really cool stuff going on. So Clint, tell us a little more about you.
First of all, I, you know, while you was giving your spiel at the beginning, I was sliding in. I apologize. And your hair looks
Thank you.
So I'm a stand-up comedian. I've been doing that for 16 years. I live in Los Angeles, but I was able to I actually called just to have a one-off podcast here. And somebody came in and was like, yo, man, why don't you just join the space? I was like, I don't know. Gave me the ins and outs of what the space does and everything that it has to offer. And I was like, you know what? It sounds like a good idea. So I did that. But, yeah, I tell jokes for a living. I got a comedy special coming out on Amazon Prime in July.
Congratulations.
I'm about to talk some shit right now. Am I allowed to say shit?
Goddamn.
Yeah. Got a comedy special coming out. that's my jam, by the way, too.
Yeah, you know the vibes. Yeah, we're going to talk about vinyls later, yeah, and D'Angelo goes right into jam. It. Yeah.
I got a comedy special coming out in July. I'm going back on tour in September. I saw y'all was talking about the Roots Picnic. One person you left off the lineup was me. You know what I'm saying? Like, what is we talking
over
about?
At the fucking, I mean? Roots Picnic. So, let's fucking go.
Yeah, I got a television show called The World Series of Spades. It's exactly what it sounds like. We will be at the Roots Picnic in the gaming section along with the University of Dope. And, you know, if you got Spades game or you know what you're doing, you can come on the table. The winner gets a $500 cash prize. Also, you get, I'm trying to think, what else? You get a $500 cash prize. Get a trophy, and the winner also gets to come on the show.
And bragging so, forever.
You don't get bragging, not for the Roots Picnic tournaments. Nah, you got to win. You got to win like the whole thing. You know what I'm saying? Yeah.
So calm down, Will. Yeah, basically, yeah, you don't. Yeah, is not, that no bragging, you hype yet. Right now? You hype right much, now? You got to be cool. You got to be chill. You already lose at Spades. You showing too much, babe.
You say showing too much.
So, with everything going on, how do you as a business prioritize everything? Like, what's your schedule like? What's it like doing the administrative and also the talent side of things?
So for me, you know, when I always thought to myself, like, yo, being talented is never enough, right? Being able to do, or just being able to tell jokes is never enough. You have to be able to do everything, you know? And the crazy thing is I have a team that does do stuff. Like, I got an agent, I got a manager, you know what I'm saying? But at the end of the day, like, I'm going to be honest with you. Doing the admin stuff is fun. Like, I hate,
type,
like,
A shit.
It's fun, yo. It's fun. And not only is it fun, but also, like, I'm very, like, organized. I take that very serious. Like, organization, I think a lot of creators, we so, you know, left brain, and we so, you know, trying to, you know, we so worried about creative. Like, be organized. I think that definitely, that helps a lot. So for me, that's one of the things that I think that's the biggest thing is my organization skills. Like, I'm very organized. Like, you come to my house, like, my shit is neat. Like, I don't
it's,
I don't,
not just people coming over neat. It's like I'm waking up to neat.
My house is always neat. Like,
yo,
always.
Clean mind, clean house, yeah. Everything in between. You don't have to get ready when you stay ready.
Facts.
And, you know, I really love what you said about that, because as a business, you got to know everything that's coming in and out of it, including emails.
Yes.
And Oprah Winfrey, Troy Carter was like, still signs her own checks.
Absolutely. As she should.
And Oprah Winfrey signs a lot of motherfucking checks.
As she should. As she should. I don't see nothing wrong with that.
And, like, they're all to Gail. No, I'm kidding.
That's real shit, though.
She's eating.
Well, yeah, like, it's just like, and then, you know, like me, I'm involved in every single conversation that my manager and my agent is having. Like, that doesn't mean that I don't allow them to do their job, and that doesn't mean that I don't respect their position. But at the end of the day, like, I just want to know what's going on. That's very important to me. I take that very, very, very serious.
Yeah. I love that. And it shows, because, I mean, your trajectory this month has been a really big month for you. Why don't you tell me a little bit about Punchline Philly and what's been going on there?
So I got to show it. No, so it's weird, right? So the reason why I don't really talk about it that much, like, so comedians, we like to, I need new material. I'm going to be honest with you, right? So, you know, now that, you know, when the comedy special comes out in July and I got to go back on tour, I can't, you know, like, I don't have the same luxury as music artists, right? Mm. You do music and you get on stage, like, all right, if I go see Mary J. Blige, and she gets on stage, she says, hey, y'all, I got this new song that I wrote. I hope I play it for y'all. We like, nah, we don't want to hear that. I want
just
the
play
hits.
Just fine for 3 hours straight.
I want the hits. You know what I'm saying? So yeah. I say that to say, like, I don't get to do the hits. I got to do, you know, I gotta refresh. So Punchline Philly every Tuesday is for real. It's a workout room for me. Mm. So every week I'm working on new material. I'm hosting, having a good time. But the main purpose for me is to work on new jokes. And first of all, I just really want to give a shout out to Punchline for allowing me to do that. Like, a lot of comedians can't come home and do stuff like that. Like, they allowed me a month to come in here and lock in and just actually, like, work on new jokes is a big deal. So that's why I really didn't talk about it that much, or I promote it, but not to you know.
So it may or may not be happening next Tuesday.
No, it's happening next Tuesday. It's just the fact of the matter is, like, you know, just know that, you know, when you come there, like, lower your fucking expectations. All right, I'm working.
Zero.
I mean, lower your expectations.
On the fucking ground. So it is you and friends.
Yes.
Who are the and friends, and how do you find said and friends to be on that stage?
Oh yeah, I mean, comedians, we just a big cool community, right? So it's like, Clint, you got stage time, I want it. And then also they can work on new material. They can also work on stuff that they got going on. And that's really all it's for. So, like, and friends is just either local comedians that I get from the area. Some come from New York. But, yeah, they just want stage time. That's it.
Or Mary J. Blige trying out the new song.
Mary J. Blige. Monet Tejada is not.
Will not be there. So sorry. Is there any difference between what the West Coast finds funny versus what the East Coast finds funny?
Absolutely. I wouldn't say what the East Coast finds funny, right? I hate to say this, right? And I'm going to say something.
But he's going to say it with his whole fucking chest.
I hate to say this, right? So I think on the West Coast, they have a better appreciation for the art of stand-up. Mm. I think in certain cities, they have a better appreciation for the art of comedy.
I think the shit ain't funny over here.
Yeah. No, y'all just don't respect comedians, and y'all think y'all funnier than us, and you're not. Like, you know what I mean? It's always somebody in the audience think that they like, here's the thing, right? Growing up in Philly, you had to be funny, right? Like, we bust on each other. We Joan. We all that. You know what I'm saying? And you think when you come to a comedy show, that's the space to do that. And it's like, nah, bro, you're going to get embarrassed. But in other cities, they don't do that. You know what I'm saying? They really only do that here. And it's like, you have to be prepared for the fact that there's somebody in the audience at all times who thinks, ah, man, I could do this too. You know what I'm saying? Like, I'm going to be honest. I started comedy because I was sitting in the audience at a comedy show. And I was like, oh, if he could do this, I could do this too. I got humbled very quick. But it takes years and years and years. Yeah, but, like, the West Coast really has a better appreciation for the arts than they do over here. I'm going to be honest with you.
No, I love that. And that's why I asked, because it's not even just a, you know, culture thing.
Yeah.
It is about, like, your lifestyle here and there. Right. So I just definitely wanted to dissect that.
Right.
But I wanted to go back to a conversation that you said about being like a musician.
Yeah.
And sometimes being not like a musician, and the fact that you can't just try new shit out. But yeah. I think comedians are like musicians in the fact that y'all need to live life in order to make this art that you're making in real time.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. You definitely got to, I go outside, you know what I'm saying?
You touch some grass.
I touch the streets. Yeah, I touch the streets, you know what I'm saying? But also living life, it's deeper than that, right? Like, it's also, you know, like, you know, finding the funny in things that you necessarily don't find funny. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Finding the funny in, you know, things that really... you know, that you deal with on a day-to-day basis and stuff like that. And that takes a lot out of you. You know what I'm saying? And you,
You're a big appreciator of music in general. You have a music podcast. Tell us a little bit more about that.
Yeah, it just got picked up by Revolt too. To throw that out there, man.
Congratulations. Yeah, so
we on the Revolt network now, man. As of right now, like, you know, today, I think I dropped my first episode on Revolt, on Tuesday, but it's called Music is a Love Language. It's basically, look, man, if I wasn't a comedian, I'd be like an A&R or something like that. I know I would be. You know what I'm saying? Or I would be doing something. I can't sing. I can't rap. But I can I could debate music.
You can send a really strong email.
Yes, facts. But I enjoy talking music. Like, that's something I could discuss all day, every day, healthy conversations. Like, not even more so who's better than who and stuff like that. But I like music reminds me of a time. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's really what it is for me. It always reminds me of, and that could be anything, right? Like, even a song that just came out last week, right? If it's a hit this summer, I will never forget that song for the summer of 2023. Yeah. You see what I'm saying? So stuff like that.
I love it. Do you have a vinyl collection? Like, how do you collect? What is your prized possession?
So first of all, my vinyl collection, I got about 18,000 vinyls. I've been collecting since I was about 16, man. My uncle passed away when I was about that age, and his wife was like, or my aunt was like, you know, you come over, take what you want. And he had a crazy vinyl collection, so I started there. My most prized possession, right, it's probably Toni Braxton's first album, but not because it's Toni Braxton's first album. It's because there was a period in time where music didn't, or like R&B and hip-hop didn't come out on vinyl from around 1991 to about maybe 2012, to be honest with you. A lot of these records didn't come, like a lot of these albums didn't come out on vinyl, right? They were for promotional use only. But this Toni
D'Angelo stuff.
Yeah, it didn't originally come out on vinyl. But Toni Braxton's record, they're not reprinting it. And her first album, it did not get printed in the United States. It was only printed overseas. So I was able to pick it up at a record shop for about $50. That record, if you go on eBay now, is worth about $300-$500. So that's probably one of my, and if I get it signed, the price really goes up.
When are you getting it signed? I mean,
I gotta meet Toni, you know what I'm saying?
So. We will. We're manifesting. What is that white whale of a vinyl or a piece that you cannot get your hands on yet?
That's a good question. Again, a lot of them joints that came out, like I was looking for Rule 336 by Ja Rule, like that came out in like 2000. You can't find that because it didn't come out on vinyl. Even Philadelphia Freeways out for album, like that did not come out on vinyl. That was on CD. Like a lot of these you can't find these. So, but eBay is if anybody who wants to like really get into if anybody wants to get into vinyls, like eBay is your hack to find the rare records.
Absolutely. So track, notify yourself. That's how I got my Bobby Caldwell. I have the heart shape.
Yeah.
On the 45. And then I think my white whale is D'Angelo Live from the Jazz Cafe.
So again, didn't come out on vinyl, and people don't realize that album or that live performance. Where was he at? Was he
London?
London. Yeah. Yes.
I have a quick question actually. Yeah. One, vinyl talk is crazy.
Right.
18,000 of 18,000, anything. Yeah.
Well, look, man.
Questlove is somewhere shaking.
No, Questlove got 35,000, man. I was just talking about him yesterday.
He's coming for me.
He has man. He got the best vinyl collection, period. Yes. Nobody's touching his.
But look, first of all, I want to say congratulations on your success, man.
Yes.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
Things you're accomplishing as a comedian is incredible. And, you know, the theme of the show today is resilience.
Yeah.
And I know that, like, the second thing that's most scary for people is dying. The first thing is public speaking, right? But I think being a comedian and standing in front of people is even more scary than just general public speaking.
Yeah.
So I'm wondering, like, have you ever had the experience of bombing as a comedian?
Absolutely.
And if so, like, what are some of the things that you've learned, right, through that experience that maybe you could share with other creatives who might feel that level of pressure or feel that level of, you know, resilience that they need to develop?
Bombing is just part of the sport. You know what I'm saying? Like, that's just the bottom line. Now, there are some comedians that I know who never bombed before, right? And, I mean, you one of the lucky ones, right? Like, you one of the ones who never got to feel the agony of defeat, as they say, right? But bombing is not as bad as you think it is, right? And the reason why is because, yeah, it's humbling, right? But I'm bombing in front of 40 people, right? Yeah, you may remember that 10 years later, but I know I won't. Right? Like, if you saw me when I first started comedy, I started in 07 at the Laugh House. If you saw me in 2007 and you're still saying, oh, he's not funny. Well, yeah, I was 19 when I started. I'm 35 now. You see what I'm saying? It just comes with the territory. It's kind of like if it's easy, everybody would be doing it. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? And also when I first started stand up, it wasn't a career. It was a hobby. I was doing this because it was just fun. I still had a regular job every day. I was still getting up in the morning. But at the end of the day, I knew at 8 o'clock at night, I'm going to do some jokes somewhere. And it was fun. I liked the camaraderie of the other comedians. And those things really kept me going, right? It's the fact that you're not the only one who did bomb. It's like, okay, well, Spank, yeah, he just bombed. I just watched him. Michael Blackson, I watched him. Like, we all, it happens. It's a part of the sport. And you can't. For the most part, you can't get away with it. And if you train yourself like that, right? And if you train yourself to say, you know what, it's a part of the game. Like, prime example, right? Mm-hmm. Fellas, you shoot your shot at a woman or a guy, whatever you do, right? You shoot your shot. Every guy has been rejected. No guy is batting 1,000.
we're sitting here in the old gallery. You know how many times I done shot my shot and lost in my, you know what I'm saying? But that don't mean I'm going to stop talking to girls. Mm-hmm. That just means she didn't like me. I'm going to keep going. Maybe my rap needs to get better. Instead of you saying, like, maybe I need to be like, hello, my name is Clinton. Like, you know what I'm saying? You figure it out. Figure it out.
It's a numbers game, and you can't win if you don't play, but you also got to run the risk of losing.
Facts. Totally agree.
I love that. So thank you, Will. Yeah, that was a really great question. So let's bring it all together. What are you up to next? I mean, we have Roots Picnic. We got our Amazon Prime special.
Yeah.
Where can we find you, and what's next?
My name is Clint Coley on all platforms. Just C-L-I-N-T-C-O-L-E-Y. That's what you just named is what's coming out next. A lot of things I try not to, you know, like, I don't disclose, right? But I'm the type of guy, it ain't happening until it's happening. You know what I'm saying?
Like, the press release is live.
Yeah, man. Like, I was sitting here, and I was thinking about the special today, and I was like, damn, do I want to talk about it? Do I say it? And I was like, but it's not going to be real for me until, like, the billboard is up, and they say, yo, Clint Coley, you know, the special is called My Edible Kicked In. It's called My Edible Kicked In. Seriously, yeah. My edible kicked in.
Like, it's time.
I'm smacked. Yeah, I'm high. Yeah, absolutely. That's coming out soon. That's the next big thing that's happening. And then I have other things going on, but, you know, I'm one of them guys again. Like,
There's a lot going on.
Yeah, man. Until it happens, it's not happening to me.
Well, congratulations. We just want to give you flowers. Thank you. I see you working really fucking hard.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
I really appreciate it. And I'm really excited to see everything. And I'll see you at the Roots Picnic.
For sure. And then real quick, I just want to say this, man. This space, I wished they had a space like this when I lived here. Mm. Like, this space is so needed and necessary. Like, I'm just keep saying that. Like, you guys, and I will say this too. Everybody on the rec staff has been nothing but friendly towards me since I've gotten here. Nobody has given me any type of problems. It's never been like it's been nothing but love, and I've felt welcomed. I appreciate each and every one of y'all for making this space, you know, or making me feel like home. And then the last thing is somebody asked me who's my favorite Philly comedian. Motherfucker, me. You know what I mean?
Wait, where is it? Come on. Y'all ain't got the wait.
You got the... B.
You made me turn the Funkmaster Flex monologue on.
Me.
I'm so sorry. I love that. Well, thank you so much, Clint.
Thank you for having me.
I'm going to let you have your morning, the rest of your day. Congratulations.
No doubt. We'll see each other at the picnic. For sure.
Awesome. Yo, how amazing was it to start the day with Clint and that energy? I mean, when it comes to comedy and music and everything in between, he's really doing the whole damn thing. I mean, again, Roots Picnic, see him there, as well as the upcoming Amazon Prime stand-up special, The Edibles Kicked In. So I am really excited for that. Again, these spotlights are for people who are working hard that I see at the space. I mean, I'm here more than I'm home. So it's really exciting to see people using the space as a home and feeling comfortable to create art in, because it's kind of like the hierarchy of needs. Like, you got to have shelter and feel safe in order to be vulnerable and make good art. So it means a ton to have Clint up here and have him here creating a Revolt podcast. I mean, the hits just keep on coming. So I'm really excited. So I'm also here to let you know about what's coming up next, y'all. Today at Rec is the Summer House Launch networking event from 4 to 7. That is free to attend. Come and hang out, meet some of your future collaborators and friends and people in the community doing really great things. That's here 4 to 7. On Thursday, June 1st, is the Small Business Summit. We've got Wallow and Gilly of Million Dollars Worth of Game here at Rec from 5 to 9, talking about the ERC tax credit and how it is supporting Philadelphians in creating sustainable businesses here in the city. So they don't have to go anywhere else. So that is happening Thursday, June 1st from 5 to 9 p.m. You can find the information to register online, because you do have to have some employees under you and some other things to qualify to come to the Small Business Summit. June 3rd, bow, 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 we got Roots Picnic After Party here with Just Blaze. It is Digging Through the Crates. We are celebrating the 50 years of hip-hop with Red Bull, where you can have Just Blaze playing, and then you dig through the crates, and you hand Just Blaze a vinyl, like, thank you forever. Like, that is so exciting. That is going to be right here from 5 p.m. to 2 a.m. So we're going to be digging through the crates. Philly Rising Open Mic at World Cafe Live. That is Tuesday, June 6th. Also, every second Tuesday of the month. So from 6 to 10, a free open mic over at World Cafe Live. We love partnering with them. This is about our second or third year. So we're excited to keep that growing and keep the talent growing here in the city. And then finally, the 2023 Black Music City Showcase is June 11th at World Cafe Live as well. So that's an exciting place to see all the grantees this year and all the hard work that they've been putting in. So shout out to REC and WXPN and WRTI and all our amazing partners across the city that were able to make this happen. We're putting money in pockets. Where's the ka-ching? We need like a ka-ching sound. Money, 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 money. But finally, jobs. Black Music City has created 4 jobs for that one event. So members, go on app.recphilly.com/benefits to apply. But we are looking for a check-in person, an on-site live engineer, a photographer, as well as just support staff. So ushering, welcoming, telling people where things are. So those are 4 jobs that are available and need to be booked by June 11th. So apply ASAP, because they will be closing that up on Tuesday, because Monday, no rec, we close for Memorial Day. But those are some really great opportunities to get paid there. But again, y'all, thank you so much for having me. Thanks to Clint. Congratulations. And also thank you for all your energy last week. It was super great holding it down for Will. But in case you missed it, that's just me. And I appreciate y'all. And that's been Cafecito Corner with Scarlett.
Check. Shout out Scarlett, always holding it down, man. Clint Coley, member doing amazing things. And one of the things that Scarlett said toward the end, she talked about Black Music City, and that's coming up. So I had this. It was sitting behind me. But Izzy, we just won an award. REC, WXPN, and WRTI were actually honored by the Arts and Business Council for our work, specifically with the Black Music City project, and you know the way we were able to give out tons of dollars directly to Black artists in our city. So, yeah, decided I'd just speak on that a little bit. This is going to get added to the backdrop. You know what I mean? Right back there. And that was actually designed by an incredible artist as well. So, boom, we'll drop some air horns for that. So, yeah, like, this has been a good show so far. But now, Izzy's here. You know what I'm saying? Q&A with Izzy. Izzy, what's going on, Izzy? How you feeling?
I'm feeling good. I'm so ready to talk about resilience.
Let's talk about it.
I just got this book, The War of Art, which is all about moving through resistance. And I was reading that literally last night, and I was like, my questions are about to come from this book.
Let's do it. So I would say one of my toxic traits is I buy way more books than I have time to read.
Me.
So I have this book. It actually is sitting in my bedroom on my dresser. But I haven't started reading it yet.
I literally have 3 books on my dresser right now. It's this one, E-Myth Revisited.
Fire.
Also recommended by you. And then one about networking.
Oh,
like
cool.
The different forms of networking.
All right, well, let's get into it. I'm about to learn today.
Okay. What is resilience, Will?
I guess my definition of resilience is something I kind of shared at the top of the show. I would just say, like, resilience is the ability to go through adversity without losing enthusiasm.
And moving through resistance.
Yeah.
Staying positive, right?
That's exactly right.
We love it. Okay. Resistance comes up in many ways. What are the most common areas you see that in?
Man, I think our tribe here is really smart, and I think someone hit it on the head earlier when they said most of the resistance is like self-resistance. It's like that mental game, you know what I mean? Like the resistance of lack of self-belief, like in self-doubt, the resistance of procrastination, right? I think that's a heavy one. I think that just that internal dialogue and conversation we have with ourselves, I think that's like the most primary resistance. But I wonder what our folks think, right? What resistance is most common for y'all? We'd love to know. Let us know in the chat.
Let us know in the chat. Well, you said procrastination, and I just read something about like procrastination and resistance. Mm-hmm. Like when you start reading this book, because I know it's on your counter, mm-hmm. it has like relationships and their connections with different things.
Mm.
So talk about the connection between resistance and procrastination and how that works together.
That's interesting. I mean, you know, I have my own thoughts on it. I think that most of the time when we're procrastinating, there's something in our way, right? There's a reason why we're procrastinating, whether that's, again, mostly it's whether it's a self-belief thing or, you know, if we really go deeper, I think it's like fear. I think really like what it is like I'm afraid of something, whether that's like for the feedback I'm going to get when I finally do this thing, or fear of rejection, it won't go the way that I want. So that's how I think about it. But since you've read the book, how do you think about it? What's the relationship between resistance and procrastination?
I think procrastination is like, you know how when you procrastinate, it's a day? It's like, I'm going to do it tomorrow.
Yeah.
That's like resistance in the closest way possible to us. Mm. So it's not like, I'm not going to not do it. I'm going to do it tomorrow. Mm. And that's resisting one day. Hmm. Like, I think in this book, it's like what you say too, constantly showing up and doing it.
Yeah.
No matter what it is, you're always going to be there. Mm-hmm. While when you procrastinate, it's a day late. I'm going to be there tomorrow.
Yeah. Ooh, that's good. So it's almost like you're resisting the present moment.
Yeah.
Right? For what it is and getting done who you need to be in that moment. Wow, that's good. And our folks in the chat says most resistance is imposter syndrome, lack of faith, being scared to commit to more responsibility. Yes, Jaleah.
Give it to us, Jaleah.
I feel that. You know, looking too far into a future that doesn't exist. Yes, Nairobi. I feel that. I think thinking too much on the past, thinking too much into the future, both of those will get you in trouble. And they'll create resistance in your life. And then don't care what people think. Do whatever that thing is that you do anyway. Interesting.
I care so much about what people think. Well,
that's okay. You're still young, Izzy.
I know, but
that's par for the course. Because the older you get, right? Old heads don't give up. They don't care about nothing.
I know.
Yeah, my dad, he is the way he is. That's how he tells me. I am. He said I'm old, too old to be caring what people think.
Hey, yo. You know, but there's some wisdom there, right? Like, and what I think is true too is, I think there's this thing, and I think they call it the spotlight effect, is we think that people think of us way more than they actually do. And that's just ego, right? Ego wants to be like, oh, everyone sees that my shirt's wrinkled, right? Like, when really it's like, I don't mind looking at your shirt, bro. Like, you know?
People probably thinking the same way you're thinking. Like, if you're thinking that, imagine what they're thinking when they're walking by you.
About themselves, right?
Yeah.
That's real. Jaleah said fear of incompetence. Mm-mm. I think that's, like, one of the biggest ones. Like, everyone, because that imposter syndrome, right? You just think you're going to get found out.
Right.
You know? Like, oh, yeah, you've been faking this whole time.
Fake the funk.
Yep.
Well, you had mentioned, like, asking for critiques or just taking that in. How do you ask for feedback?
Directly, right? Like, a part of that is even after these shows, right, we always do a huddle after. We talk about, hey, what went well this show? But also, hey, from everyone's perspective, where can we grow? You know, what didn't go so well? I think even more powerful feedback in your personal life is, like, go ask the people close to you, not your family, like, not your mom, right? But, like, ask your real friends, like, yo, what do you think about this, me in this area of my life, right? Like, asking the people that you trust enough that are actually going to keep it real with you, not the people who have some invested interest in, like, making you feel good all the time. And just be direct. And I think the more specific, the better, right? Because, like, sometimes you could ask for feedback, but it's not specific enough to actually be useful, right? Like, for example, you know, if I'm talking to my business partner, Dave, and it's like, yo, man, how do you think I showed up in that conversation with that employee, right? Not like, yo, how do you think I'm doing as a communicator? Because that's just, like, too broad, right?
Yeah,
it doesn't actually give me the insight that I need most.
Exactly.
So I think being direct and also being specific.
What if you don't directly work with the people as often and you still want to get feedback?
I think it's still valuable, right? You just have to keep in mind, like, what that relationship is. But in some companies, they have what it's called, like, 360 feedback, which means that, like, if you sit here in the org chart, you get feedback from your higher-ups, but then you also get feedback from your direct reports, right? Yeah. So, like, it helps you kind of calibrate of, like, how well am I being led and executing, but also how am I doing as being a leader. And I think sometimes they even, like, across, right, you get feedback from your peers. You know, every company is different, but I think, like, sometimes it could be helpful to even get feedback from people who don't work super closely with you, because they still see how you make other people feel, and right, they be hearing how other people talk about you, right? So right, I think sometimes you can glean value from that, too.
So is that, like, a last couple episodes you talked about the rule of thirds.
Yeah,
like, I love your that. Head, and then your peers, and then below.
Yep.
So is that who those people, if you don't work in a company, would you ask those people to show up and...
Absolutely. Yeah, that's a good point. So I love when you bring old ideas into the present convo. So again, the rule of thirds is the idea of you should spend 30 of your time with people who are on your level, right? They have things in common with you. They're grinding alongside you. Spend a 30 of your time with people who are further down the road, further on their journey, and then spend a 30 of your time with people who are behind you, right? Mentorship and things like that. All of their feedback is important, just for the data.
Yeah.
Right? Because I think sometimes, like, for me, when I get really, like, in my mind and I'm, like, I have this racket of, like, damn, we're not doing enough and, like, this is happening, everything's on fire. But then I ask, like, a Tariq who sits on our board who's, you know, been a part of billion-dollar businesses, and he's like, nah, you guys are actually doing great, right? Like, it just helps you recalibrate, right? Because everyone has different perspectives, and that's helpful. But then also, like, when I talk to someone who's behind me and they're, like, looking at all the cool things we're doing, you know, they might be like, from my lens, y'all are crushing, right? But it's about getting that balance, because sometimes, like, yeah, you need the balance. I'll just put it that way. You just need the balance.
Now, since I brought that up, and that was past episodes ago, I had questions after that episode. So, like, how do you know who's one of your peers, who's below you, and who's ahead of you? Obviously, I feel like I know who's ahead of me. Yeah. But, like, my peers and my down below, I sometimes find a struggle navigating through.
How do you know, kind of like, what bucket to put people
in? Yeah, mm-hmm. Or what bucket to even put yourself in? Because I know who I'm around.
Yeah, that's a really interesting question. And I think what makes it tricky is, like, the whole social media culture of, like, posting your highlight reels. Because, like, you might perceive some people of being ahead of you that, like, if you really looked under the hood, they're actually, like, on your level. Or even maybe, like, not even doing as well as you are. So I think that's tricky. And I also think if you do a good job at listening, people will tell you when they think that you're ahead of them. You know, and just the way they treat you and the questions that they may ask and things like that, like, they, in their mind, will put you in a certain place. Like, they'll put you on a pedestal, they'll revere. So I think listening does a good job. But I think you can only really know by getting to know people, you know, because the social media thing is, like, people are going to put on the front, you know.
Definitely.
And also, I have to make this point, too. Like, when we say about someone being ahead of you or behind you, that can change. It could be the same person, but they may be ahead of you in finances, but, like, behind you as, like, a confidence as a creative.
Different buckets.
Right? So it's important to also know that, like, it's not just this universal thing. That person's better than me in every way. And that's why when we talk about mentors, like, it's so vitally important to have mentors around a specific thing. Mm-mm. Like, you know, like, if you start trying to idolize someone and, like, oh, I'm going to learn everything they do, eventually it becomes, like, that. Like, that's what parents are for.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Like, but if someone's, like, really good at business and you love the way they structure deals or the way they communicate with their staff, then, like, cool, that's my mentor for that. Or mindset mentors, right? Mm-hmm. Spirituality mentors. Choose a thing, because we're all humans. We're all flawed. So no one's got it all figured out. No one's got it all perfect. So we have to be really mindful.
Pick and choose.
You know? And I think sometimes, like, culture allows us to want to be like, oh, my God, Beyonce. I want to model my every version of my, every part of my life after her. And then that's when you get into things like Swarm. Get crazy.
You know, as we talk about, like, our relationships with different people,
yeah,
resistance creates allies in different ways and brings people in your life who might, you know, cause resistance in some form.
Resistance creates allies in different ways. What do you mean by that?
Okay, can I bring out the book?
Please, go for it. You're teaching me today.
So I... like resistance by like self-sabotage, maybe bringing in someone in your life that's like giving you more resistance. And I also read something where it's like resistance in relationships where if you feel like you're lacking, you might talk to someone who is like pushing forward so that you feel like, oh, I want to let them have the light. So I'm going to resist myself as your self-sabotage moment.
Interesting. Wow.
It's an interesting book, guys.
Yeah, it sounds really good. So what I'm hearing is like you're saying when you have certain resistances in yourself interpersonally, you tend to attract other people who can either distract you from your resistance, or sometimes you can attract people that make you feel better about your own resistance because they're doing a good job in that area. Is that what you're saying?
I think I understand it. First one, yes.
Okay.
And then there's a second one where it's like, you know how community is everything?
Yeah, for sure. Independent doesn't mean alone.
Yes.
Yep.
So big in my life. Yeah. But you could be in communities where they're all resisting. So everyone falls back because everyone doesn't want to push forward.
Wow. Yeah, that's powerful. Yeah, I was having a conversation with a friend about relationships and dating. And we had this conversation around sometimes when you choose a partner, what you subconsciously do is like if you're weak in a certain area of your life, you like try to find a partner who like is really good at that thing. And like before you know it, it's like, oh, I actually don't love this person. I love the security that they have, or I love the whatever, the confidence, right, that they have, because I don't have that, you know. And I think it's just really important. And I think that's what leads people to like want to try to find someone to make them whole, as opposed to, like, getting whole and then, like, finding someone else who's whole. But that's interesting. I love the framing of, like, the things you resist yourself open you up to attracting other people like that or distracting you from it. Mm-mm. I think that's really powerful.
I think it's interesting.
Yup.
Oh, you said something in standing in temporary failure.
Yeah, that's so important.
I want to know, like, what are the feelings and emotions you work through when standing in your temporary failure?
Man. It get deep. I think, right, temporary failure, right? Let's use the gym analogy. They say that, like, your best workouts are when you work to muscle failure, right? And in that moment, you can't put up another rep. And you probably feel weak at that point, right? Like, for example, when you're at the gym and, like, you see, like, some chick that you think is cute and, like, you hit muscle failure, like, and then it looks like, dang, that's not that much weight, bro, and you can't even lift it. But what they don't know is you just did, like, 4 sets, right? You feel shameful, right? You feel like, oh man, I'm weak. I feel inferior and all of those things. But you got to know, right? Again, every project's about the next project. So it's like, yo, the whole point was for me to get to muscle failure. So tomorrow I could be a little bit stronger. And that happens in other things. You fail and you feel silly. You feel inadequate. You feel whatever. But sometimes that's what builds you up and gives you that fuel to be like, I want to get better. I want to master this thing. So I think it's just really healthy. That, again, constructive struggle.
Mm-mm. I like that.
That's right. So look, I think it's time for us to start winding down the show and wrapping it up. It's almost 11 a.m. The morning coffee has been had. We got to get back to the rest of our days. And it's a full day here at Rec. We got a lot going on. That's a fact. I just want to shout out everyone in the chat, everyone who's sticking around with us to the end of the show. Y'all are the real ones. Man, Izzy, appreciate you. Scarlett, Clint, you know, everyone who contributed to today's show, Miles, Frank, man, Riley, Cannon, appreciate the full team effort today. But yeah, today was about resilience, you know. I hope you guys get to take a little bit of that theme throughout the rest of your day and throughout the weekend. We're all on a marathon, you know, so it's important that we don't get too distracted by temporary failures, that we don't really keep our eye on the grand prize. Failure is not the opposite of success. It's really a part of success, right? You got to fail your way forward to get there. But yo, much love to y'all. I hope I see y'all out in these streets this weekend. Again, we at the BWC Sounds John on Saturday. It's a day party, Cherry Street Pier. And I guess we got one more show before Roots Picnic, right?
Right.
Cool. So next Friday, we're back at it. Before that, that'll be fun. But listen, feels good to be back. Oh yeah, let's give away a little bit more money before we do. So my man Cannon be throwing the Cash Apps in the John. So if you put your Cash App in the chat, it's here. And I didn't forget about y'all earlier. I'm just on IG Live, so I couldn't Cash App y'all in real time. But we're going to get you too. Let me just grab some. Oh, you did it? Are you going to do it? I'll do it. Wow, Cannon, out of your own personal money? Dang, Cannon like you.
Cannon, big baller now.
Oh, you ain't get reimbursed. Oh, all right, say that. Cool. All right, look, bang, my man Johnny. Wait, y'all can't see it, but John Jukebox, you got, boom, you got some, boom, you got it. Ah, John Jukebox. You can't see it. It's tough.
It's good. Like,
but yeah, trust me, it says John Jukebox. You got some coffee money coming your way. I appreciate y'all. It's lit. Oh, Selecta, my fault, yo. Selecta said she got Allspice this weekend. We ain't shout that out. It's up. Go to Allspice. Go check out Selecta. I appreciate y'all. This has been a great show. It feels good to be back. But listen, let me say this before we go. I've already decided what the theme of next show is, and it's actually going to be a series. So, like, the next handful of shows are going to revolve around the same theme, and I'm really excited about it. I believe that these next five shows are going to be the best shows yet, specifically around the theme and what we're talking about and the value we're going to be giving up for us as creatives. So please make sure y'all come back, be a part of that. Go tell some other people, you know what I mean, why you be coming to Morning Coffee, invite them too. Let's get real. You know, it's time to start leveling this up even further and continue to give us the feedback, right? We're talking about feedback and critique. Let us know. Hit us up in the DMs or wherever. What do you love about the show? What do you think we have room to grow on? We want to make this the best possible show for creative entrepreneurs. So that's it. As Scarlett would say.
Reminder to be good to yourself and be good to others.
And that's a wrap. Love y'all.